If you are just joining us here on this Wednesday, one of those weeks. Two major headlines coming out of today in the Russia investigation. You have sources saying that special counsel Robert Mueller, as I mentioned a second ago, plans to question former White House chief strategist Steve Bannon about the dismissals of both the now fired FBI chief James Comey and the former national security advisor Michael Flynn. That is according to sources. Also, sources say that Mueller wants to ask the president himself about both Flynn and Comey. My next guest is someone who has questioned a president. Someone in the late 90s. Solomon Weisenberg is the deputy independent counsel in the investigation of President Bill Clinton and his affair with Monica Lewinsky. Solomon is now a federal white-collar criminal defense attorney. So, sir, nice to have you on.
Thanks a lot. Nice to be here, Brooke.
So just first, your interpretation of all of these developments, and if you want to comment on the White House spokesperson calling this whole thing a hoax, feel free. But, you know, the fact that Comey and Sessions have been questioned and plans to question Bannon by the end of the month.
I think it may be an indication that things are wrapping up for the heart of the investigation, but it's very speculative at this point. Very difficult to say.
Tough to say, maybe wrapping up, and of course the big fish at the end of this presumably is the President of the United States. We know that the President's lawyers will likely push for what we've heard, written answers. This is according to sources to CNN. I imagine Mueller's team won't bite on that, right? They want him eyeball to eyeball. So in a standoff over an interview, Solomon, what are the leverage points for each side?
That's a great question. First of all, there's no way Mueller's team will accept only written responses. Mueller's team will say, we want to question you. Then the president will have to, and his attorneys will have to make a decision. They can say, sure, you can question us, question me, and let's talk about the ground rules. Or the president can say, pound sand, in which case Mueller will issue a grand jury subpoena. And then the president will decide whether or not, A, he goes to the grand jury and testifies, almost certainly not. B, he invokes his Fifth Amendment privilege against self-incrimination, which doesn't sound quite as crazy as it did when people first started talking about it, and see whether he says to Mueller, kind of like Bannon did, okay, since you've subpoenaed me, I'll go and have an interview with you.
Mm-hmm. So in the room, and let's picture the room, you have the president, presumably his lawyers present in the room, then you have Mueller and his team. Is it Mueller who does the questioning, or is it someone on his team, and Mueller pipes up for a question here and there?
My assumption is that the person leading that particular phase of the investigation will do the questioning, with Mueller obviously having the ability to jump in. Mueller, unlike a lot of people who are U.S. attorneys or special counsel, actually has a tremendous amount of law enforcement experience, so he would be fully capable of doing it. The real key about an interview, if President Trump has decided I'm not going to invoke the Fifth Amendment, you really want that interview to be informal so that Ty Cobb can be in there, maybe John Dowd too, can be in there with the president. Because as a person who sat in many interviews with clients, there's a lot you can do as an attorney to protect your client in such an interview. If, for example, Bob Mueller asks a question that's ambiguous, you can say, hold on a minute, Bob, do you mean this or do you mean that? If your client, in all innocence, gives an answer and has left something out that you know he has left out unintentionally, you can say, wait a minute, Mr. President, you forgot about this. That's something that happens all the time when clients go in to be interviewed, usually after they've pled guilty, but it can be for proffers or anything like that. And the role of the attorney is very important. The attorney can limit damage. And of course, I believe that if President Trump does allow himself to be interviewed, he'll be very well prepared by Ty Cobb.
Okay, so let's get to it, Solomon. You were kind enough. We asked you to come up with a couple of key questions that, you know, if you were a lead investigator or a Mueller himself, would ask the president. And you said, hey, I'm just going to read your question number one. Were you mad at Comey's handling of the Clinton email probe? Why is that key?
Well, I don't know that it is key, because let me preface what I'm going to say is, based on the public record that I have seen, I don't think there is much of an obstruction case, unless there are things that Mueller knows about that we don't, which is quite possible. I thought that was an important question, because the president has indicated that he was mad at Jim Comey's handling of the email investigation, but did you think he went too easy on Mrs. Clinton, or he went too hard? I actually think the most, if I'm not jumping ahead, the most important question to ask the president is, did you tell anybody, any of your people, to repeat or to give any false story to federal investigators? Because to me, it doesn't matter how many false statements the president made. I'm not saying he made them, but how many false statements he made publicly or his people made publicly. The question under obstruction law is, did you make false statements to federal investigators? That's the most important question, I think.
But Solomon, to your point about you don't think this is much of an obstruction case, and you're the pro when it comes to this kind of thing, but don't you remember the interview that the president gave with NBC's Lester Holt, where the president himself acknowledged, yep, you know, I let Comey go because I wanted this Russia investigation to essentially go away?
I believe that is almost completely irrelevant because he has the constitutional authority. He's not above the law, but he has the constitutional authority to fire Comey. So the fact that he's firing him because he thinks Comey's getting too close to him, to me, is not criminal obstruction of justice. Congress might want to impeach him for it, but it's not criminal obstruction of justice. And let me just tell you, I've seen people on TV, my counterparts, people are all over the block on this.
I know the
case law is not rock solid. There are some appellate level cases that have language that indicates it's enough if you have a corrupt intent, even if you're doing something that's otherwise lawful. I disagree with those, with that. I don't think those in all of those cases there was incredibly deceitful and criminal activity involved. I believe that's dicta. I don't believe those cases, that proposition holds water. There are two Supreme Court cases, not directly on point, but they seem to indicate that to have criminal obstruction, you've got to have some kind of deceit of investigators. You've got to have some independently criminal activity. So the law is unsettled. Nobody knows for sure. I don't think there's a case based on what I've seen.
Okay. Another question you gave to our producers for the president that you would ask. Did you know Justice Department attorneys had already told Sessions that rules mandated his recusal?
That's of some importance, because if the president knew, let's say, for example, that some Department of Justice ethics attorney said, you know, under this federal regulation or statute, you've got to recuse yourself. And the president knew that and asked and went ahead and had somebody ask AG Sessions anyway to recuse himself, you may be getting a little closer in that circumstance. But I think the most important question still is, what instructions did you give to people, if any, to tell a fake story to law enforcement? I do think a very important question would be, did you hear about any of these Russian offers of dirt during the campaign, having dirt on Hillary Clinton? And if so, what, if anything, did you do to indicate that you wanted that dirt delivered to you? That's obviously a relevant question, because there's a law that forbids knowingly and willfully relying on aid from a foreign government during a campaign. But even that law requires that you know you're violating election law when you do that.
These are all excellent questions. You would know. Solomon, please come back. I wish I had more time with you, but I have a feeling we're going to be talking quite a bit more about this potential scenario. So let's chat again. I appreciate you very much for joining me.
My pleasure.